So far in his short NFL career, Michael Thomas has been a force on the field. In his first 3 years, he's acquired 321 receptions for 3,787 yards and 23 touchdowns. The only NFL players to have more receiving yards in their first 3 seasons are Randy Moss, Odell Beckham Jr., and AJ Green. And he's the only player in NFL history with over 300 receptions in his first 3 NFL seasons. In most NFL circles, he's respected. And if you're looking at a top 10 list, he's usually somewhere around 5. Yet to this day, he's still criminally underrated. Most average fans wouldn't even know who he is. And if you compare him and Odell's internet presences, Odell dwarfs him with 13.1 million Instagram followers to Mike's 625,000, even though he and Odell have had very similar starts to their careers. But this disrespect isn't something new to Mike. At the 2016 NFL Draft, 5 wide receivers were taken before Mike had his name called as the 47th overall pick by the Saints. Now, in today's video, I wanted to take a look at the 5 wide receivers drafted before Michael Thomas and how their careers turned out. But before we get into this, let's take a look at how Mike got to where he is today. Growing up in the Los Angeles area, Mike played football at Taft High School in Woodland Hills, California. After a dominant senior season there, he'd become a 4-star recruit. But instead of playing college football, he ultimately decided to spend 1 year at Fork Union Military Academy before going to play at Ohio State. While there, he roomed with his future Ohio State quarterback, Cardale Jones. At night, they would talk about the future and dream about how one day they would be at Ohio State making the biggest plays on the biggest stages. Little did they know how true this would become. After only catching 3 balls his freshman year in 2012, the Ohio State staff decided to redshirt Thomas for his sophomore season in 2013. Now, at first, this didn't look like a great move, but my oh my, did this pay off in 2014. Mike would ultimately finish his junior season with 54 catches for 799 yards and 9 touchdowns. And with the help of his former roommate Cardale Jones, they would both lead Ohio State to a national championship victory over Oregon. The next year, during his senior season, he put together another great year, compiling 56 catches for 781 yards and 9 touchdowns. He was ready for the NFL. But leading up to the draft, a couple receivers in his class were viewed as superior prospects to him. And scouts said he lacked aggressiveness and struggled to run routes. These factors led to Mike falling to the Saints, a huge mistake for all the other 31 NFL teams.
47th pick in the 2016 NFL Draft. The New Orleans Saints select Michael Thomas.
Reese hesitates for Michael Thomas, and it's Johnny.
So far in his first 3 years, Mike has been nothing short of spectacular, filling up the stat sheets and making clutch plays, and has obviously established himself as the best wide receiver from his draft class. But there were still 5 guys taken before him who haven't been anywhere near as good as him, so let's take a look at who they are now. Alright, so the first receiver taken in the 2016 NFL Draft was Corey Coleman with the 15th overall pick to the Cleveland Browns. This guy is the first of many receiver busts on this list, but I can see what Cleveland was thinking here. Going into the draft, their best receiver, Josh Gordon, was suspended, and they had a huge hole to fill at the position. When they pulled the trigger on Corey, they definitely saw the potential. Coleman had won the Biletnikoff Award at Baylor in 2015, and had finished that year with 74 catches for 1,363 yards and 20 touchdowns. He had blazing fast speed with a 4.37 40-yard dash, fast enough to take the top off at any NFL defense. But so far in his 3-year career, his most significant achievement has been dropping the potential game-saving pass in a Week 17, 2017 game that doomed Cleveland to an 0-16 record. In 3 years, he's compiled 61 catches for 789 yards and 5 touchdowns, or in other words, Mike's stat line by Week 10 most years. After being consistently injured and missing 21 career games, he's on his 3rd team in 2 years and is currently a backup receiver for the Giants. Corey absolutely had the talent to succeed. and he did show some flashes on the field. And even though the quarterback play he's had has stunted his growth to a degree, a combination of his attitude and health are the main reasons for his bust status, but who knows, maybe he could turn it around in New York. Looking back on this pick, the Browns absolutely would have gone with Thomas given a second chance, and imagine this current Cleveland offense with Mike there. Now for the second receiver taken before Thomas, Will Fuller, to the Texans with the 21st overall pick. Coming into the draft, Fuller was a similar prospect to Coleman, with both of them being small and having blazing fast speed. At Notre Dame, he was a big play machine, compiling 62 catches for 1,258 yards and 14 touchdowns in his final year there. In the evaluation process, there were some concerns about Fuller's frame and ability to hold up at the NFL level, but his talent was so immense, he still went in the first round. So far, he's been pretty good at what he was projected to do, being a deep threat. And when he's been healthy, he's averaged a stat line of 3.45 catches for 50.35 yards and 0.42 touchdowns a game. Which, I mean, is fairly mediocre compared to Thomas's 6.83 catches for 80.57 yards and 0.49 touchdowns, but it's still respectable for a number 2 receiver. So far, he's been an explosive player, and has created some awesome highlights with Deshaun Watson, even having a stretch of 7 touchdowns between weeks 4 through 7 of 2017. But you know the saying, the best ability is availability, and so far he's missed 17 career games to Thomas's 1. So given a second chance, the Texans absolutely take Thomas here. Now, the third receiver taken before Thomas was Josh Doctson, with the 22nd overall pick to the Washington Redskins. Josh played his college ball at TCU, and he was a beast there, especially during his senior year where he had 79 catches for 1,327 yards and 14 touchdowns. Most scouts saw his huge 6'2" frame and jump ball ability, and envisioned him making all types of plays in their offense. But so far, this just hasn't been the case. Doctson has had the issue that most of the other guys on this list have had, missing games. So far, he's missed 15 career games, but even when he does play, he's been nothing special, averaging 2.45 catches a game for 33.3 yards and 0.24 touchdowns a game. He struggled to create separation and yards after the catch. And even though he has made a few exciting plays in his career, for the most part he's pretty much put up wide receiver 3 numbers, and not the numbers of a first round pick. At this point he'll probably be out of Washington after next season, and if the Redskins were given a second chance here, this is once again another no-brainer, they absolutely go with Thomas at this pick. Alright, now for the fourth receiver taken before Mike, Laquon Treadwell with the 23rd overall pick to the Vikings. This pick right here was probably the worst pick of the entire draft. I mean, Laquon has been god-awful. Laquon was the number one prospect in the country coming out of high school, and played his college ball at Ole Miss. He had his best year as a junior in 2015, where he had 82 catches for 1,153 yards and 11 touchdowns. He was a similar prospect to Doctson, in that they both had a 6'2 frame and were great at high-pointing the ball. He was so highly touted that his pre-draft comparison was DeAndre Hopkins. So far, Laquon has been about as bad as a first-round receiver can be. Playing in 9 games his rookie year, he only caught 1 ball for 15 yards. His career stat line has been 56 catches for 517 yards and 1 touchdown. Also, when you consider that he's played in 40 games, the second most out of anyone on this list, his numbers are even more putrid. He's averaged 1.4 catches for 12.93 yards and 0.025 touchdowns a game. Yes, you heard that right. For a first-round wide receiver, he has 1 career touchdown, while Thomas has 4 games where he scored 2 touchdowns. In a Week 2 tie to the Packers, Vikings head coach Mike Zimmer summed up Laquon's career perfectly, when he said, "Treadwell's got to catch the ball," after Laquon dropped a pass to set up the game-winning field goal versus the Packers. Laquon would ultimately finish the 2018 season with the second highest drop rate of any receiver, and at this point, it looks as though Laquon might be one of the biggest busts in recent memory. So it isn't going to take too much brain power to figure out who the Vikings would have taken here. And now, for the last receiver taken before Thomas, Sterling Shepard of the Giants with the 40th overall pick. Now, ironically, the last receiver taken before Mike has turned out to be the best of his group. Sterling went to college at Oklahoma, where he played with Baker Mayfield as his college quarterback. In his senior year at Oklahoma, he had 86 catches for 1,288 yards and 11 touchdowns. Coming out, he was a smaller guy at 5'10", but was a smooth route runner and had great hands. And so far, these two observations have been true. In his 3 years in the league, he's been a great fit in the Giants' offense. catching 190 balls for 2,286 yards and 14 touchdowns. He's been about as consistent as it gets, and has only missed 5 career games. He's a very good number 2 receiver, but I could see him struggling as the Giants' number 1 this year due to the departure of Odell. Although he isn't that true number 1 like Michaels, the Giants still got a great complimentary piece to Odell here. And out of all the receivers from this list, he is the first one to get that elusive second contract when he signed a 4-year, $41 million deal, something Thomas hasn't even gotten yet. But given a second chance, it's obvious who the Giants would have taken here, Mike. Now that we've seen all the guys taken before Mike, it's honestly appalling to see how dominant he is compared to them. All 5 of these guys combined have 495 catches for 6,253 yards and 41 touchdowns, while Mike alone has 321 receptions for 3,787 yards and 23 touchdowns. The other aspect to look at in comparing Thomas to these other guys is health. Barring Sterling Shepard, every single one of these guys has missed a significant amount of time during their career, compared to Thomas, who in 3 years in the league has missed only 1 game. Now, I can't just ignore the elephant in the room here. Thomas was blessed to play with Drew Brees, one of the greatest quarterbacks of all time. And who knows, maybe if he gets drafted by the Browns, he struggles for the first few years with the inept quarterback play of RG3 and DeShone Kizer. But I have a feeling that no matter where Mike would have ended up, he would have been great. The story of Michael Thomas and all the other receivers that went before him really epitomizes the lesson that NFL executives need to stop focusing on if he can run like a receiver and more if he can play like one.